Welcome to Eureka Moments, a celebration of vaccine science superheroes. My name is Seema Kumar, and this broadcast is our effort to bring you stories of hope, stories of scientists behind the headlines whose Eureka Moments are improving human health. I'm broadcasting live today from the Johnson & Johnson Historical Powerhouse Museum. Behind me are incredible stories of scientific innovation, extraordinary tales of heroism from the past. But today, we bring you stories from the present. Stories of science superheroes whose efforts have helped combat the COVID-19 pandemic. Their work to develop vaccines unfolded before our very eyes in real time as the world grappled with the uncertainty of the pandemic and the stakes could not have been higher. We see the headlines, we read the news, we watch experts discuss and debate the science and innovation, but who are the actual people doing the science? What inspires them? Why do they persevere against all odds? What does it take to go after impossible problems? The dedicated men and women who are on the front lines behind the lab coat are fighting against disease, and they are a special squad of superheroes. Eureka Moments is our attempt to bring you their stories. Today on Eureka Moments, we'll be presenting the Dr. Paul Janssen Award to two of the world's leading scientists on mRNA. We'll then speak with vaccine scientists from across the world. Finally, we'll be joined by entrepreneur and television personality, Damon John, who will share his own health journey and talk about how we can mine for new ideas to fight against inequalities we see in healthcare. But first up, the Dr. Paul Janssen Award. Dr. Paul dedicated his life to solving for patients' medical needs, just like the scientific community, which mobilized so quickly last year to develop the vaccines. And one person who was right in the middle of all of that quest was Dr. Paul Stoffels, Johnson & Johnson's chief scientific officer, who's here to present this year's Dr. Paul Janssen Award. Paul, welcome.
Thank you, Seema.
Paul, do you remember that moment in Davos in 2020? I mean, at that moment, the world was just learning about COVID and the coronavirus. And then some of the first COVID-19 vaccines got underway. More than a year later, what impresses you about what's happened so far?
Well, first, Seema, I remember the moment very well. It was the third week of January. And when at Davos, at the World Economic Forum, we had the first meeting with scientists and the global leaders on what might this bring. This looks like something which could get dangerous. And then some international infections were reported already in Singapore and in other places. And you said, okay, this is not going to be stopped here. This is going to be a pandemic. And I called the lab back home and I asked Anneke Schuitenmaker, Anneke, should we consider start working on this? And she said, well, Paul, we're already on it. The code has just been published and we are making the first construct for making a vaccine. So, okay, that's what they call entrepreneurship, and the lab was already going on it. And since then, in a very extreme accelerated way, 12 months later, we were able to bring a vaccine as well as other people, other companies. It was a fantastic collaboration between so many partners, academic, industry, government, NIH, global partners who joined us in clinical trials. And 12 months later, we were able to get to a vaccine, which is now worldwide used for protection of people.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, it is just when you think back about it, it's incredible. Now, you know, Dr. Paul probably would have been proud. You knew Dr. Paul Janssen personally. What do you think? I mean, how excited do you think he would have been, and how impressed do you think he would have been watching the scientific community respond this way to the pandemic?
Yeah, I was able to work with Dr. Janssen, one of the heroes in the history of medicine. Imagine if you are working in antifungals, in antibiotics, in neuroscience, in psychiatry, in all different areas. He made 80 drugs over his lifetime with his teams. And we learned how to collaborate as scientists. We also learned how to go fast when needed. For example, in our days of HIV, we already trained for going really fast, where we counted hours and days instead of weeks and months in drug development. So let's say, to a certain kind, he prepared us and the company was prepared to take on this type of challenges. And that's where he would have been very proud. And absolutely a big, big supporter for what we're doing here.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, earlier today, Johnson & Johnson announced Katalin Karikó and Drew Weissman as winners of the 2021 Dr. Paul Janssen Award for Biomedical Research for their work and their foundational work that enabled the use of messenger RNA in the development of COVID-19 vaccines. Both of you, congratulations, Dr. Drew Pressman and Dr. Katalin Karikó. Welcome.
Thank you.
And congratulations. So our show is about Eureka moments. And I want you both to think about your own Eureka moments. I mean, Katie, when did you first have this Eureka moment about mRNAs and mRNAs being so useful in therapeutics?
So actually, I wanted to develop messenger RNA for therapy, yes, not for vaccine. And so when the first time we delivered the messenger RNA coding for a protein, which was very complicatedly processed and that's needed for the function. And when we have seen that this protein was really functional, we thought that, yes, messenger RNA will be a therapy. At that time, we thought that only, you know, ex vivo and cells, not in vivo, because the level protein was not high enough. But that was it. And many, many times in my research life, wanted, you know, I hardly can wait tomorrow or be a week older, because then by that time I will know the result.
So what about you, Drew? So Eureka moment.
There's so many of them, it's hard to pick out one. But probably the first Eureka moment, you know, Katie and I met over the Xerox machine. The story's been spread around the world. And we decided to work together and to try her RNA on dendritic cells that I was studying. Dendritic cells are the prime cell for starting immune responses. So they're the key to start an immune response. And Katie gave me RNA and I made dendritic cells and I added the RNA and then waited, I think, 6 hours. And I looked at them and I said, these cells are activated. And that didn't make sense to me because our cells are full of RNA. Why would adding RNA activate them? But looking back on it, that was probably the critical moment in figuring out how to make RNA be able to be used as a therapeutic. Because of that activation, we spent 7 years figuring out how to get around that.
So from therapeutics, how did you make the leap towards vaccines? When did you realize that, both of you?
So I was always interested in vaccines. Mm-hmm. And you know, I was also interested in therapeutics. I was interested in gene therapy, but I never gave up using RNA for vaccines.
And why were you interested in vaccines? Any specific diseases?
Yeah, I'm an immunologist. Yeah. I trained in Tony Fauci's lab at the NIH where we worked on HIV. So I started off interested in developing an HIV vaccine, and we're still working on that.
So yes, still, fingers crossed, one day there will be an HIV vaccine. Now, you know, you have the Eureka moments, but then it takes a lot of time and effort and years of perseverance before you can actually see that particular Eureka moment become a realization and become something that people can actually use. Talk a little bit about both your journey. I mean, how long ago did you begin working on this? And how long did it take to actually solve the problem?
I mean, I started to work in 89 on messenger RNA and to develop for therapy, as I mentioned. And so when we realized together that the messenger RNA is inflammatory, I mean, I was very disappointed because already 10 years I was working on making therapeutic RNA, and I thought that it won't be good if it is inflammatory. And when realizing again, after so many experiments, that nucleoside modification is needed, you know, came the question that how we make modified nucleoside containing RNA. And then, you know, when we realized that the RNA has double-stranded RNA contaminant, again, that how we would purify. And again, every time was that nobody ever done it, and we have to figure it out. And maybe it is not possible, but we kept doing and trying different, many, many different things.
Drew, anything you want to add?
Yeah. No, I completely agree. I think, I'm an MD, PhD, so I see patients, and my focus was always on developing therapeutics that would help people. That kept me going, but it also kept me with my mind wide open because, Katie and I would sit down and think about all the therapeutics that mRNA could be used for. And the list just kept going and going and going. And that spurred me on, and I'm sure it spurred Katie on, to continue that. If we were looking for an antibiotic for an unusual bacteria and spent 20 years and failed, we probably would have given up. But there were so many diseases, so many things that RNA could be used for that it kept us going.
And we could see also that it was, the RNA get better, we get more protein. And so the improvement was continuously.
Yeah.
Sometimes incremental, sometimes, better improvement.
Yes, more. It takes years of work. And Paul, vaccines were developed in record time. And people think, oh, wow, this was developed in, a matter of years. But this is all based on foundational work that was done a long time ago. It just didn't drop out of the sky, did it?
Well, we started working on HIV back 30 years ago. Yeah, first we made medicines and were able to control the disease by stopping the replication. But it was clear that we never would be able to get the disease out of people. And so therefore we needed to go to vaccines. So we teamed up with a biotech company who had a platform, Crucell, back in 2010. Yeah. And we started thinking, how can we use that technology to make an HIV vaccine? But on the way, other diseases showed up, like Ebola. So we made an Ebola vaccine. We made a Zika vaccine. And so we were actually prepared. We worked on HIV vaccine and still are. We, in order to get progress on eliminating HIV in the world. And so we built a technology, built a production platform, and suddenly COVID arrived. And so we were ready to tackle very quickly, step in, maximize the number of people working on it. And since then, a few thousand people stepped in, both on the development, on the manufacturing, and on the distribution, all the aspects in the world. And that's what was possible to do it in 12 months. But we didn't do it on our own. We also worked with the NIH, with the clinical trial networks, with academia. You will see some of our collaborations later, which really contributed first to making the right construct and then do the clinical trials. The regulators worked with us in days, not in weeks or months. We got interaction on the minute with the FDA, with EMA, to make this work. And that's why we could pull 5-6 years of scientific development into 1 year without giving in on any part of it, non-activity nor safety. We were able to study it very extensively and show the safety and the efficacy of the virus. So it was the combination of being ready to tackle it with the science and all the platforms, as well as the organization who can do this type of mobilizing thousands of people to work it in a 12-month time frame. Yeah.
Wow, still incredible, all of the work that went into it. Now, there are lots of young scientists watching the show, and many others who are younger still who might want to think about a career in science. What advice do you have for them? Drew, you want to go first?
So my advice is, if it interests you, if you enjoy doing it, then you need to do it. You need to try. It's not an easy career, but it has the potential for everybody. People think, oh, well, Katie and Drew are getting this award, but it isn't us. There are thousands and thousands of scientists who have done work that has helped us get here. And there's going to be thousands more that take what we develop and make new drugs and therapies. So if it's in your blood, if you feel the interest in being creative and exploring, then you need to do it.
That's great. And you, especially for women in science.
Yeah, so very important that you have to enjoy, because you will spend most of your life doing experiments, and you have to be excited and enjoy it. And for the young one also, I can say that it can be intimidating. how much is already known by others and how much you have to absorb. And so very important that you have to believe in yourself and feeling that you will be able to put through and will discover something that nobody thought about, because they might think that it is not doable, you know, those more experienced, and then yes. You don't know about it and you will do it.
Yes, absolutely. And all three of you here have had the thrill of the discovery, the thrill of that Eureka moment, and the thrill of making an impact and changing people's lives for better. Well, congratulations to Katie and Drew. Thank you for the impact you've made on all of our lives. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for sharing your Eureka moments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Over the past few weeks, a new virus emerged in China, in Wuhan, a coronavirus, which could be of global concern. And the laboratories in our company already started to work on, can we make a vaccine against this virus? It's all in preparation for waiting whether this is really going to be a global health emergency or not. But we can't wait as a company to get prepared and put all our efforts together, you know, to make sure we are ready when needed.
At the moment, you're working with the Harvard Institution, where 50 to 100 additional scientists are working with us on accelerating the first candidate vaccines. At the same time, in Leiden, we have a large contingent of our own researchers working on the A26 vector.
Thank you for your tireless efforts as you continue to work diligently and ensure our high ethical standards and scientific principles as we develop our COVID-19 vaccine candidate to help combat this pandemic.
Welcome back to Eureka Moments. Who knew standing there that the entire world would face an unprecedented global emergency in just a few weeks? Across the world, tens of thousands of scientists across industry, academia, government, all set out to fearlessly work on and a tireless race against the virus to bring forward their best ideas and science and technology into action. Today, we're joined by many of these superheroes on the front lines of the COVID response. Professor Dame Sarah Gilbert from University of Oxford, Dr. Tanya Villafana from AstraZeneca, Dr. Dan Baruch from Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center, Dr. Andrea Carfi from Moderna, and Dr. Hanneke Schutemacher from Johnson & Johnson. Thank you all for being here. So let me start with you, Dan and Hanneke. When did the two of you realize how serious a threat COVID-19 could potentially be?
Dan, you can go first.
Oh, thank you. Well, early in January, we were hearing the report.
Over the past few weeks, a new virus emerged in China, in Wuhan.
Early in January, we started hearing the reports coming out of Wuhan, China, and it was really unclear the extent to which it posed a global threat. But there were clinical signs suggesting that it might be more problematic than the original SARS, such as the lack of symptomatology or mild symptomatology in a fraction of individuals. It raised the specter of potential asymptomatic spread, which obviously increased the risk of a global pandemic. And in early January, then we started conversations with our close colleagues from J&J, Hanneke and her team, and we decided that we would work together on this. And as the months proceeded, then the importance of what we were jointly doing became very, very apparent.
Yes, indeed. I experienced it exactly like that. And it was very interesting to see the curiosity of our scientists to immediately keep an eye on the web to see what was being published on this new pathogen, and of course, monitoring what was happening in the world to already start thinking about what a vaccine could look like and how we could potentially help in should this indeed develop into a problem. And I think it was really heroic that we could already decide to start working on a vaccine long before it was called a pandemic. I think that was really what was needed in a fast response to what could happen.
Wow, incredible to think how much has happened since then. Sarah Gilbert at Oxford, let me ask you this. I mean, can you take us back to those early weeks, and what steps were you focused on in those first couple of days, couple of weeks?
Well, I first started to see reports about a virus outbreak on the first day of January in 2020, and independently, some of my colleagues were following reports as well from different sources. And so, because I work in this area of vaccine development, we decided within the first few days we would be interested in making a vaccine without knowing if it was ever going to be needed at that point. And as we got more information, found out that it was a coronavirus causing infections, that gave us a steer as to what we were going to do about it, because we'd worked on a coronavirus vaccine before. But what we started to do was as much work as quickly as possible without knowing how far the vaccine development would need to go. We did a lot of work in case it was needed, knowing that if it was needed, we needed to start as soon as possible. So that really set the tone for the whole year, getting going as fast as we could, waiting to see if the work was going to be needed. But at every stage, it turned out that it was.
So, Dr. Karfi, I mean, we talked about this with Katie and with Drew, but how much of the work that you had done previously gave you a foundation for your success as you developed vaccines for COVID-19?
Yeah, I think, thank you. No, I think the work that was done previously was fundamental to be able to advance the vaccine quickly. We had, you know, generated clinical data for a number of other mRNA vaccines. So we knew that the technology is safe, immunogenic, and so we could raise, you know, immune responses in humans, which was a big question for, you know, mRNA vaccines. And also, I think the experience that we had gained in manufacturing was essential. So we were really at a time where we were, you know, start planning, you know, how to scale up and how to make the technology available for more people. And that was essential really to be able to do what we have done later. So the, you know, experience both from a clinical perspective and manufacturing was essential. Plus, maybe let me add also the work that we had done in, for, you know, in the preclinical space, also with our partners at BRC and NIH, where we had, of course, learned about the immunogenicity of the platform against other coronaviruses, such as MERS, was, of course, fundamental to accelerate the development of the vaccine.
Yeah, I mean, it's extraordinary. I mean, a lot of being a scientist involves like trial and error, which means failure is a big part of developing new medicines, new vaccines. Tanya, were there times when you thought it was never going to happen?
Well, certainly. I think what we've done together as a community has been unprecedented. And there were times during the process, I think we all had those feelings or thoughts, are we going to get here? I think we did an amazing thing in the past 18 months in getting so many vaccines to populations around the world to help combat the pandemic.
That is great. I mean, you know, there were so many, what seemed like it was playing out in real time, the setbacks, the disappointments, but then the progress and then, you know,
absolutely,
victory. Now, you know, you've all said this, which is that, you know, the race was not against each other, but the race was against the virus. How was the collaboration in this particular circumstance so different from what you've experienced before? Maybe I can ask each of you to comment, starting with Dan and Hanukkah, maybe.
Sure, I can start. I think the global urgency of the situation was really bigger than any of us. And I think everyone shared a desire to do everything that we could to help stop this pandemic. And that urgent desire was something that many of us had never felt before, at least not to that extent. And let me just give you a couple examples. So apart, obviously, from our own collaborations, then in terms of cross-program collaborations, there from the very start, there were early WHO calls that drew scientists from all around the world, covering everything from animal models to assays to epidemiology and many other topics. And in those large international calls, people would just routinely talk about work from their lab they generated the previous day or the previous week, much earlier sharing of data than what would ordinarily be acceptable. Locally, within Boston and Harvard, there was the establishment of the Massachusetts Consortium for Pathogen Readiness that basically was a a group of scientists and physicians from around the greater Boston area. Andrea and I were both part of that, and we actually co-chair, even to this day, the vaccine working group for that organization. So I think there was really an unprecedented level of information sharing, reagent sharing, because we knew that this problem cannot be solved by one individual or one company alone. It really requires the joint efforts of all of the major companies to stop this pandemic. And I think that's what we're seeing today.
That is great. And I think, you know, there's also examples of public-private collaboration and public-private partnerships, right? Mm-hmm. Tanya and Sarah, maybe you could comment on that.
Yeah, absolutely. I can start, Sarah. But when we partnered with Oxford to develop our COVID-19 vaccine, that was an unprecedented step for us. And we really had the goal to support Oxford in its vaccine development efforts, bringing our development and manufacturing capacities into that equation. And our goal really was to make a vaccine as broadly available and equitably available across the world as possible. So I was very proud actually of our senior management for making that commitment and just saying at the beginning of this, how can we help? How can we work with Oxford to deliver this vaccine to countries around the world? So that was really unprecedented. And the collaboration with Oxford and with Sarah and the team there has just been an incredible experience. I've worked in many public-private partnerships, but our collective action, the amount of work, the things that we align to do together, our commitments together, have really made a difference. And I hope to be able to work with that team again in the future, hopefully not in a pandemic setting like this.
Hopefully not. Yeah. Sarah, anything to add?
Well, obviously it's difficult to put together a brand new partnership while you're trying to respond to a pandemic, but we were all doing it for the right reasons. And we were delighted to work with AstraZeneca and their commitment to make large amounts of the vaccine available without profit. And they really did work extremely hard in getting the manufacturing scaled up and working with lots of different partners in different parts of the world. It wasn't always easy for us. We were busy. We were trying to do our clinical trials and work on our own vaccine production. And we had to work with AstraZeneca and pass on the information. So it gave us extra things to do. At the time, we were pretty busy already. But we knew it was absolutely vital to be able to get this vaccine ready for use. And as academics, we wouldn't be thinking about market supply of vaccines. But we knew we needed somebody to do that. And we had to support AstraZeneca in enabling them to make that happen.
That's great. Thank you. I'll ask Andrea maybe to comment briefly and Hanukkah briefly as well, and then we'll go to our last question.
Yeah, I mean, I think for us it was critical, the partnership and collaboration with NIH, and, you know, we had worked with the VRC specifically even in the past, so it was very natural to work with them, but it was an amazing collaboration where we basically almost had one lab, you know, with, you know, recurring meetings and sharing data and plans. And so, and this is really across, you know, from the preclinical through the clinical development. But also, I think I want to acknowledge the collaboration, not only at the academic level and, you know, across the US and the world, I would say, but also with regulatory agencies that really, you know, provided and helped us to advance, you know, all these vaccines, you know, quickly through development.
Thank you. I mean, Hanukkah, go ahead.
No, I wanted to confirm and also say that, of course, I knew a lot of people from the HIV field, which has been an ongoing pandemic for years, and knew a lot of people there. And they were immediately transferred into the COVID response, which also made it very easy because you knew each other already, and it really facilitated the networking. That, of course, also applied to our collaborator, Dan, who's here today as well, that you know each other and that you know how to get from A to B and to bring success as fast as possible.
Thank you. And, you know, this show is about Eureka moments. So to all of you, was there one Eureka moment, one aha moment when you started to feel that you may actually succeed in developing an effective COVID-19 vaccine? Maybe we start off with Tanya, you first.
I was hoping you wouldn't start with me, but there were so many moments. But, you know, I think it was towards the fall of last year. And I think, you know, it was just a stronger feeling as we were preparing to have data readouts that we were going to get there. And certainly we saw, you know, that the same wave of expectations across the different vaccines at that time. But I think when I really knew we had a vaccine that was going to go into people's arms was when we had our first call with an agency at 4 a.m. in the morning on New Year's Day. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, this is it. So it was pretty exciting.
Congratulations. Sarah, do you want to go next?
Well, for me, there weren't really any eureka moments. It was a progression of work that we've been doing previously, gradually adding to the data, moving through the stages that we needed to go through, making sure we had everything in hand. I think my favorite moment, though, was after the vaccine was licensed and we started to see effectiveness data. So we started to see that it was actually protecting people over the age of 80 in Scotland, and it was keeping them out of hospital. So the vaccine that we first started working on just over a year previously was actually keeping the most vulnerable members of our society out of hospital, and that was really great.
Thank you. What about you, Hanukkah?
Yeah, I remember so well because we were struggling which vaccine candidate to select, and we had our own opinions on what would be the best candidate. And then Dan gave me a call on a European time Sunday afternoon, and he said we got our lead candidate. So that was because it gave full protection in non-human primates. And one of the goals we had set based also on WHO target product profile, that we really wanted to get a one dose vaccine out, but because all the models showed that would have largest impact during a pandemic. And these non-human primate data were with a single shot. So we were really with that on track. And I can still feel the goosebumps when I talk about it, because that was truly a very special and emotional moment.
That is great. Goosebump moments. We had a lot of those this past year, for sure. Andrea, what about you?
Well, for me, it was when we saw for the first time the phase one clinical data, because we knew that, you know, not everyone infected was asymptomatic. So personally, I had the sense that it was not a virus that was very hard to fight. But the question was, is the vaccine tolerable and are we going to get immune responses? And the phase one data were actually impressive for, you know, a new technology and mRNA, and completely de-risked the program from my perspective. So that was really an exciting time where I thought, you know, we might succeed and we might get to efficacy.
Dan?
I guess two moments, one of which was the joint moment with Hanukkah and her team when we realized that the candidate vaccine could protect monkeys. That was around, I think, maybe May or June of 2020. But there was actually one moment before that, earlier on in April 2020, when we had done our first non-human primate study, not with a vaccine, but just with natural immunity. And we showed that in an animal model in non-human primates, that natural immunity would protect against rechallenge. And that demonstrated that a primate immune system could protect against SARS-CoV-2. It seems obvious now, but at that point in time, there was tremendous uncertainty. It was uncertain whether a human or a primate would generate protective immunity to a SARS-CoV-2 infection. And we know from the history of vaccinology that if there is natural immunity to a pathogen, then it's much easier and a much more straightforward path to build a vaccine. So when we first showed natural immunity, even without any vaccine, then suddenly I thought that vaccines were going to be possible. It wasn't clear which vaccines, which platforms, which inserts, but it suggested that a vaccine was going to be possible and hopefully multiple vaccines could be developed.
Thank you, Dan. Well, one final question for all of you, rapid fire. What's the biggest lesson you learned from this past year? And how do you think the breakthroughs that you've developed will help us respond to the next pandemic? And since Dan, you have the floor, I'll start with you this time.
I think collectively what this last year and a half has shown me is what is possible. And what is possible when there's a will and there's a way, there's a global need, and there's a desire for something to succeed. And I think that has occurred with, you know, all of the co-panelists today, as well as many others who have really brought collectively all the vaccines to the world.
Sarah, what about you? Lessons learned?
So I think what I've learned is that we need to be ready for the next one, because unfortunately there will be another one. And we don't need everybody to be thinking about that, but we do need the experts to be thinking about that and thinking about what we learned as to how we could have gone faster, what would have made the ride smoother last time, and apply those lessons now so that we're better prepared for the, for when this happens again.
Andrea?
Yeah, I think for me it's the two aspects. I mean, the collaboration, right? That there's nothing impossible that we cannot achieve when we collaborate and work together. And I think that's really the result of this, you know, what we have done during the pandemic. And then I agree that, you know, pandemic preparedness, right, really be ready for the next one. That's something that we have to do for the future. And I think that if I can say, what we've learned is that there are technologies that actually are very suitable to respond to these situations, and that's a really opens and new avenues for the future.
Thank you. Hanneke?
Yes, I fully agree that all these scientific investments prior to when this pandemic hit have shown tremendously beneficial for the rapid response. And I really think we need to build that climate of additional technology developments, technological developments, because that is key. And one other thing is focus, because what you see is that if everybody is focused on the same goal, that a lot of things happen much faster and in an excellent way.
Thank you. And Tanya?
Hi. Yeah, so believe the impossible is possible. I certainly learned that in the past year. Another important thing is the resiliency of people and of our teams, and the ability of people to just, you know, work for incredible amounts of hours to deliver on a shared goal, and the importance of collaboration, not just with our partners at Oxford, but across the industry with health agencies, with recommending bodies, and the importance of keeping that collaboration going.
Thank you all. Thank you. And thanks to everybody for a great conversation. I know that each of you represents the thousands of other scientists and colleagues who helped make this happen. And in honor of you and the other vaccine science superheroes, Johnson & Johnson will be making a $100,000 donation to IntraHealth International, which is a nonprofit organization supporting frontline healthcare workers tackling COVID-19. They are another squad of superheroes that we've come to depend on. You're watching Eureka Moments. As we've learned today, Eureka Moments, or the spark of an idea, is just the beginning. It takes years of research and science, not to mention funding and mentorship, to make progress, especially for communities of color. Access to science, funding, and resources have been a huge hurdle for communities of color. And the issue of equity in science is certainly not new. But COVID brought those issues into sharp focus, highlighting the dual pandemic of COVID and racism. It keenly highlighted important issues in diversity in clinical trials, access to healthcare, and access to innovation and funding. Ensuring diversity in vaccine clinical trials became a key mandate, as did the importance of empowering communities of color to own and innovate solutions for the community by the community. Last year, Johnson & Johnson announced a $100 million initiative called Race to Health Equity. And today, in an effort to accelerate innovation, J&J announced a new innovation challenge, the Johnson & Johnson Health Equity Innovation Challenge. And joining me now is entrepreneur and television personality, Damon John, and Shirley Sylvester Sr., who's a medical director of Women's Health in the Office of the Chief Medical Officer. Damon, welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Damon, you have a very personal reason for being passionate about equitable access to healthcare. Can you share your personal story?
Yeah, sure. So, growing up, I didn't know much about healthcare and not much about, getting checkups and all those type of things. The information wasn't widely available. Of course, there wasn't the internet and a lot of other things. So I had this, this form of neglect, just thinking I can go and just get a random, check on my body every year. And one time a friend said to me, with all the money you have, why don't you go get an executive physical? And I said, what is an executive physical? I've never even heard of that. I go get an executive physical at UCLA. I get ran through all the machines like I should do every 2 years. They say, hey, we're looking for to see if there's anything clogged in your carotid veins. Nothing was there, but they said you should go check it out. You have a small little nodule somewhere on your thyroid. And I go and, they said, listen, we're going to do a biopsy and 90% chance we're going to figure out what it is. And there's 10% chance we will not know what it is. And of course, I get the 10% chance of not knowing what it is. They said, listen, you could be taking out a perfectly good thyroid, at 50 years old, or you could be taking out something troublesome. I go and, 45 minute surgery turns into 3.5 hours of removing a golf ball size of stage 2 cancer. That wouldn't have came to mind at all, unless I was talking to people who said there is way more than just going and getting a simple checkup. And I think in our community, we do not think about things such as colonoscopies, endoscopies, and all the things that we should be doing that can really help us be ahead of the curve, with early detection.
Yeah, I mean, what a scare. And, and I think it brings up the important point of just getting your annual checkups on time and ensuring that communities are educated about getting their health checkups. And Shirley, now turning to you as a specialist in women's health, how is COVID-19 impacting health equity for women of color today?
Thank you, Seema, for the invitation and for sharing this panel. COVID-19 continues to affect communities of color in the US and across the world. For women in particular, we are at the intersection between race and gender, so the issue is even more problematic. On one hand, we have seen data that of the increased mortality in men, but in many other ways, women have been hardest hit by the pandemic. And we have seen, for example, that the majority of healthcare workers are females. There is a high impact in job losses in women as well. And then when it comes to maternal health, the field was already not even. But then COVID-19 has amplified this gap and has exacerbated the health disparities that already exist in pregnant women of color. As an example, we see that communities of color have high rates of comorbidities that are going to affect or going to impact COVID-19 even more. There is a hidden problem that we don't talk about much, and is the disproportionate rates of anxiety, depression in Black pregnant women and women of color in general, and even suicidal ideation. And then another element that is often not discussed and we overlook is the fact that the healthcare system that surrounds pregnancy and birth historically has relied on in-person care, and this possibility is not really happening too much in the pandemic. So pregnant women are not having the support that they need. So when we see, there's nothing new about these patterns of injustice, but as we continue to think about how are we gonna move back past the pandemic, it is imperative that we take these disparities into account so we can move forward in an inclusive way.
That is an excellent point. And I think that COVID-19, Damon, expose serious gaps in health equity. And of course, to solve for that, one of the big issues that we need to solve for is through innovation. innovation and challenging the status quo is key to addressing these issues. So what needs to be done to empower entrepreneurs and scientists with diverse backgrounds, diversity of gender, race, expertise to create new solutions?
Well, it's going within the community and giving more opportunities such as you've done for education. It all starts with education. And a lot of times they don't feel like they have the opportunity to have an education or get a seat at the table or to bring ideas and technologies to the forefront. And it has to come from people who are living within the culture and in those communities. You know, often, you know, if they don't see people that look like them who come from the same background, they don't feel that it's for them, or they feel it actually is something that is detrimental for them, as we've seen. And if they're not getting this right, the right communication, right information, there's a lot of bad information out there and people just don't trust. You know, even after my scare, as I've shared it with a lot of my friends, thank God I did, because literally about four or five of them over the course of the last 5 years have found out they had gastric cancer or various other things, and they would have never went and got a checkup if it wasn't just for that simple thing of me saying that. So imagine somebody from a scientific background telling people how this can help, you know, their lives, their family lives, their quality of life, but they have to see people and hear from people who understand where they come from.
Well, thank you, Damon, and thank you, Shirley, for, you know, sharing your thoughts and for joining us on talking about this important issue. And we are launching the Johnson & Johnson Health Equity Innovation Challenge today precisely because we want communities of color, entrepreneurs, innovators to actually come forward with the best ideas to solve for health equities and health inequities in communities of color. So we want to thank you both for joining us, and we want to give people some information about the J&J Health Equity Innovation Challenge. Please visit jnj.com/healthequitychallenge, and applications are open until November 12th, and we'll be granting over $1 million in seed funding to entrepreneurs to come up with ideas that just might change the world and just might change the landscape in terms of inequities. So imagine, I mean, we're launching this in six cities. So six cities, 600 ideas, infinite possibilities. So submit your ideas and spread the word. Thank you so much to Damon and to Shirley. Thank you for joining this conversation.
Thank you as well.
Today's conversation has given us great insights into the people behind the headlines and what makes science tick. With the pandemic came the greatest health crisis of our time. However, as we learned today, this path to success started decades ago, maybe even centuries ago, by scientists who believed their work could change their lives. Dr. Paul Janssen is no longer with us, but his legacy will live on. And with this award and in the scientists that he continues to inspire. From everyone at Johnson & Johnson, congratulations again to our 2021 honorees, Dr. Katalin Karikó and Dr. Drew Weissman. And thank you for watching Eureka Moments.